Do you remember what
Yes,
we
ma'am.
saw in the last class? Anything? Kanda, are you able to hear me? Kanda? Kanda, are you there? Yeah, yeah, just I can hear you. Do you remember what we saw in the last class? What's Kanda? Can you be a bit louder? Let me see what I can do. Yeah, yeah, tell what we saw.
Odometer, ma'am.
Okay, that is in the screen, so you are telling. Okay, what else we saw? Did you take the notes? Did you write the notes?
How to measure, ma'am?
How to measure? How to measure what? What we measure?
Speed, ma'am.
Speed, right? How to measure speed? Can you tell me the formula for speed? Can you tell me the formula for speed?
Distance by time, ma'am.
Yeah, correct. Good, Skanda. Good. That is what the speed is. Okay, so we saw how to measure speed and all. 1 minute, Skanda.
Yes, ma'am.
Right, Skanda. So we saw about speedometer, odometer, the measurements. And do you remember about this, you know, the time conversions? If it is in a kilometer, how you will convert it to meter per second and all, right? We saw these, okay? So we'll now see how we can represent in a graph, okay? Here we started this, right? But we have to complete this. We were left with completing this, right? Yeah? Okay. Right. So now what we can do is
we started this,
right? So we'll see how we can draw a graph, okay, for your distance and time. That means your speed, for your speed, how you can draw it in the graph. And what two entities you have to draw a graph for speed? That is nothing but distance and time. Okay, with distance and time, you'll draw a graph. And that will give you what? If you draw a graph with distance and time, what you will get?
And speed?
Yes, speed. Okay, it is speed only. Is your brother is near you?
No, ma'am.
No?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Right, so we'll start now. Good evening, Ananya.
Good evening, ma'am.
What happened? Why so late?
Sorry, ma'am, I had some issues.
Right, okay. Okay, so today we'll see how to draw a distance time graph. Okay, in physics, we just saw this, right? In the last class about time, motion and time. Types,
yes,
of motion,
ma'am.
Right? So here we continue with this. Okay, how to draw a distance time graph. Okay, so I already told you how a graph will be. Okay, so this is how your graph will be. Okay, so it will be separated like 1 centimeter cubes. Okay, 1 centimeter. This is 1 centimeter cubes. like, and in between so many stripes will be there, okay? And all these stripes will measure you 1 millimeters, okay? So you can find 10 such stripes to make 1 centimeter. 1 centimeter here, 1 centimeter here. So all the 4 sides, 1 centimeter or 1 centimeter squares, okay? And so you'll have multiple squares like that. What's Kanda?
That's graph sheet only, no, ma'am.
Yes, yes, this is graph sheet only. Okay, so in this graph sheet, what we can do, we can plot, okay, we can plot your points. If you have two things, okay, if you have two things means by comparing both, you can plot the points. You can find what you can, you know, what this will be the outcome from those two points. Okay, so this is what we can do here. And you see here, there is this graph, we can separate into 4 boxes. Okay, like this. Okay, how we can separate them? Through x-axis and y-axis. Okay, so this is y-axis, this is x-axis, and with this you can separate them. Then it is, when it is separated, you will have 4 columns. Okay, so what are those 4 columns? What we call these columns as? Ananya, can you turn on your camera?
Ma'am, I have some issues. I told you, ma'am, I can't switch on.
Okay, okay. It's not a problem. So can you tell me what is this? What we call this one such column? I told you in the last class.
I forgot, ma'am.
You forgot. Right. We call them as quadrants. Okay, how we call them? We call
quadrants.
Them as? Yeah, quadrants. Q-U-A-D-R-A-N-T. What, Skanda? Right, okay. So we call them as quadrants, okay? So this is your first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, and fourth quadrant. Okay, like this, it will get separated, okay? So now we'll go into our distance time graph. Okay, this is all about an intro of your graph, how to plot, what is graph and all, okay? So now going to start with this. See, a graph which represents the distance traveled by an object with respect to time is called distance time graph, okay? How many distance you are traveling, okay? A graph which represents distance traveled by an object with respect to the time, that is nothing but distance d by t. Okay, so this is what it is. It's called a distance time graph. And with this, you can get your speed. Okay, you do this and you'll get the speed. So that is what your graph will also show. So mark the x-axis. The first thing what we are going to do is marking the x-axis and y-axis. Okay, and divide them in equal quantities. Like this. So in our graph, what we are doing is we are first taking the graph and we are dividing them into x and y coordinates. Okay. X and y coordinates.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Kanda.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
No, ma'am, I have network issue, ma'am. I can't hear you the voice.
Now, can you hear me clearly?
Now it's clear.
Right, okay. So, now we need to mark the x-axis and y-axis and divide them in equal quantities. So, we are doing that here, okay? We have divided them into equal quantities. What's Kanda?
What is x-axis and y-axis?
What is x and y-axis, right? See, x and y, why we tell us, okay, I told you in the last class itself why we are using this. Okay, I'll tell you once more. Okay, whenever you see a paper, you draw something that we call it as two-dimensional. Okay, it is called as two-dimensional. And those two dimensions are x and y.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and but mostly
yes, ma'am.
When we are in this real places, you can see a 3D picture. See, this is a 3D one, okay? When you see your hand or any object in your surrounding, they all are in 3D. Okay, you can view them in 3D. How means? This will one dimension, this will be one dimension, and this will be one dimension. Like to say, keep your hand like this. Keep your hand like this. So in this, and also in this. When you see an object, okay, keep your hand like this and see, okay, what are those 3D and all. See, if I take a paper, okay, I'm taking a paper, I can fix it here, right? I can fix it here. That means this paper is just 2D. Okay. It is not coming in this thumb, right? It is just fixing with these two. It is not coming to my thumb, right? But if I take a book instead of a paper, let's say it's a book. Okay. This is a book. And if I'm taking that, see here, I'm holding it like this. Okay. You can see this. It has gone to thumb also. You know, thumb also being occupied. And also these two. Everything is occupied. That means this is having 3D. Okay. But a paper will have 2D only. So that is what here means. This X and Y are 2D. Where you can draw like this, 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 and this, this, this. Okay, you can't produce it into the 3D out of this. From a screen, you can't produce in 3D. Okay, so this is what these X and Y are. Clear?
Yes,
Ananya, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we are marking our Y and X axis now. Then choose one scale to represent distance. Okay, so these are scales. Okay, these are scales. Scale means what? Where you have heard scale? What is scale?
Ma'am, it's expressing the unit, that value, ma'am.
Correct, okay. It is kind of a measurement, okay? Like measuring one. So that is what we call it as scale. What's Kanda?
Oh, ma'am, I answered to measuring.
Okay, okay. So that is what a scale is. And we are marking it as scale. So this is a line where I'm going to measure. And this is a line where I'm going to measure. So we are telling them as scales. Okay. So now what we are doing is we are taking one scale to represent distance. Okay. So for example, x-axis to represent distance. Okay. Where 1 kilometer is equal to 1 centimeter. And the other two represent time. For example, y-axis to represent time. Okay. So here you can mention time and here you can mention distance. Like this we are taking. Okay. Mark the values of time and distance in the graph. But what will happen means, okay, when you draw this graph, distance time graph, you should always remember to mark your time in the x-axis. Okay. Always time will come in the x-axis. And distance will come in the y-axis, or distance or any other quantity will come in the y-axis, but always time will come in the x-axis. Okay, so now we are marking our time in the x-axis, that this scale or this coordinate, and y-axis is our distance. So such a way we are marking. The next is mark the set of values of time taken and distance covered in that time by the object in the graph. So what we are now doing is, okay, we need to know what we first initially before going to this graph itself, we need a table, okay? Then only you can plot a graph. So what table you need means, let me draw it here, okay? So what table we need to first have is, what is your time and what is your distance? At each time, see, at from this minute, okay, 0 means 0 distance I have traveled. After 1 minute, I have traveled 5 meters. After 2 minutes, I have traveled 10 meters. After 3 minutes, I have traveled 15 meters, like this. Okay, so this is what your tabulation will be, okay, because every time you move, your distance will be covered and the time will also run, right? So distance and time together, they'll move. Okay, so such a table we need. Okay, so this will tell us that you have traveled to 3 minutes and you have traveled to 15 meters, right? From 0 to 3 minutes and 0 to 15 meters you have traveled. So this information you need first. And now we can plot it here. Okay, so here they have taken your kilometers in the sense, okay? 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, 3 kilometer, 4 kilometer, 5 kilometer. And time also in minutes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like this they have taken. Minutes and time. Minutes of the time and distance. Okay. So this they have marked here. Now draw lines parallel to x-axis and y-axis at the points that you have marked. So now what you'll do, okay, as I told you before, this is my table, okay? At zero time, zero distance is there, right? Okay, that means at zero time, zero distance will be traveled. So I am marking a point like this here. And the next point is, for 1 minute, let's say this is kilometers. Everything are in kilometers, okay? Everything are in kilometers. So for 1 minute, 5 kilometers has been traveled. So here when we going to plot, so for 1 minute, that is one is here, 5 kilometers has been traveled. So my point will be somewhere, okay, like this. So I will be taking my line to this point and this is going to be my point. Okay. So this is how you'll plot a graph. Okay. The next, okay, where is Kanda? Okay, right.
Ma'am?
Yes, yes, Ananya.
That line should go to that 5, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
Like, if I'm saying just for 1 kilometer only, for 1 minute it has been traveled means, I'll mark it here. Okay. But here it has traveled 5 kilometers. So I'll mark it here. Okay.
Now, okay, ma'am, I understand.
Okay, clear, right? If I say for 3 meters or 3 kilometers, 2 minutes it has taken, then where my point should be?
Ma'am, that distance should be in 3, ma'am, and that time should be in 2.
Yes, okay. Like this, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Skanda, are you getting it?
Ma'am, the meeting point is the speed, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, speed, yes, speed will be the meeting point here, okay? Right, the speed will be the meeting point here. But how we'll be telling it means we need to divide them both. So then only you can produce this point. That is dy by dx you'll say, or y by x you'll say. Okay, that's why, see, how you can find out your speed if it is in this point, or let me say I'm having a point here. Okay, so how I'll be finding my speed in this point? I need to divide my distance and also time, right? So what is my distance here? So if I go and meet my distance, it is 4 here. So 4, my distance divided by the time. So this is what will come. So 4 by 3 it will be. And it will give me the speed. Okay, whatever the division, okay, after dividing, whatever the value comes, it will be my speed. Okay, Ananya. So always when you want to find a point's value, you go for y by x. Y by x, that means y coordinate divided by x coordinate. Okay, or else when you're substituting like this, this formula you need to substitute means you compare it y by x. So in y coordinate you'll take distance and the x coordinate you'll take time.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, right, in this way you'll do. Okay, Skanda has left again. Right. okay, we'll move ahead. So this is how you'll be plotting your points. Whatever points you have taken, you'll be plotting it all in this way. So now next thing what you'll do is, okay, mark the points where these lines intersect on the graph. These points show the position of the moving object. So the positions, where their positions are there, all these positions will be shown by these points. Now, okay, now join all the points of intersection and obtain a straight line graph. Okay, it says that now we need to mark every point. So let's just erase one point here. Okay, we don't want this point because at same time, you can't be in two directions, two distances, right? So we are erasing this point here. Okay, and we will mark now. So from zero, at 1 minute, it has gone to 5 kilometers. And from 5 kilometers, at the 2 minutes, it has gone to 3 kilometers. And three, it has gone to 4 kilometers at 3 minutes. So you see, this is the graph's line. Okay, Ananya, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Kanda, where did you go? Okay. So Skanda, here you see, okay, we just connected all those points, you know, in a way that it starts, okay, it goes with the time. So in this way, we connected these points here. Okay, just zero, and for 1 minute, it has gone for 5, 2 minutes, it has gone to 3 minutes, it has gone to 4. So like this, we have marked, okay. And now next thing, this is the distance time graph of a moving object. So that is all, okay? So in this way, if you mark means this is your distance time graph, okay? Where you can easily see at this point, where what is my speed? At this point, what is my speed? Or else you can say from home, okay? Let's say that from home, you have come to your school and what kind of speed you have maintained at each circumstances. So you can find out with this graph. So what kind of speed you have maintained, whether you have stopped at some point to eat something while returning from school, and after some time, what speed you have started. So everything you can find in this one. Okay, clear. So just take a screenshot and note these points.
I already wrote it, ma'am.
You already wrote it. Okay, good, Ananya.
Last class itself, I wrote, I completed it.
Okay. Skanda, you took the screenshot?
Yes, ma'am.
Skanda, you need to copy it in your notebooks, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
You should not skip them. Right. You already written. Right, good. Okay, so now, next one is the shape of the distance time graph. How they can be, okay? We saw different types of speeds, right? Like uniform, non-uniform, and average. These and all we saw, right? So how you can put them in the graph? This is what we are going to see now, okay? Right, okay. So now what you are seeing is shape of the graph, okay? Depending upon your shape of the graph, you can tell what was your type of motion is. Okay. So when we saw about uniform motion, uniform, non-uniform. So all these motions we saw. Okay. So by seeing the graph itself, you can tell those shapes also. Okay. So this is what your distance time graph will intimate you. So now if my shape of the graph is a straight line, okay, then the object has a uniform or constant
speed. Should I write this one?
Yes, of course. Okay. So when your graph is having a straight line, okay, that means it is maintaining a uniform motion. Okay. So what is your straight line? In these three lines, a green line or red line or a blue line? What is the straight line,
ma'am?
Green line, isn't it? See, a straight line being drawn here.
I think it's slanting line.
Yeah, in a slanting way, it has moved. That means what? Distance also increasing. When it moves like this, distance also increasing. When it is slanting, that means time is also increasing. See? Time will be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So when it is slanting, it means that time is also increasing. And when it is in this way, distance is also increasing. So both of them are occurring simultaneously. Then it is a uniform motion. Okay. For each time, because when it is having a straight line means whatever the portion here. So let's say this point. Okay. And this point, whatever the part it has covered, the same part only covered at every points, right? You can see this. See wherever I've marked, equal distance is being covered here, right? So that means my graph is a straight line, and it says it's a having a uniform or constant speed. Okay, so this is what your straight line graph will intimate you. Okay, then if it is a parallel to time axis. So what is the parallel line here to time axis? What colored line is parallel to time axis?
Red color, ma'am.
Red, yes, correct. Okay, red is the one which is parallel to your time axis. Okay, see here, this is goes like this, and it is having a line straight. Parallel means you all know, right? Any line is there. When it goes like this, this is my parallel line. Okay. So this is what parallel here. With time, a parallel line has been gone. Okay. So parallel to time axis means that says it is a stationary object. What is a stationary object? What is stationary?
Ma'am, I never heard of it.
Heard of this, right?
I only know that pencil, that's the...
That's stationary, right? Skanda, do you know what is stationary? Skanda, do you know what is stationary? No, okay. Okay. We can find it out, okay? But this is not that stationary, or pencil, books, okay, erasers. It is not that stationary. That stationary will have this spelling. Stationary. This is stationary. Okay. This is having N-A-R-Y. So this is different from that. Okay. So what we can understand from this graph? From that, we will find it out what is stationary. See, it is going, you know, it is also maintaining a straight line. That means it is following a what motion here?
Uniform motion, ma'am.
Yeah, right. Okay. So for some time, it has been maintaining a uniform motion. See, steady speed. Okay. Uniform motion it has been maintained. But then only, okay, for time is increasing, but no distance has been increasing. Then means then what kind of motion that object is under on? Distance is not increasing, but time is increasing. What kind of motion it might have there? Just think. See, you are in your school and you were returning to your home. For some time, you've maintained a speed. You covered some distance, you covered some time. Then, after some time, your time alone is increasing, but you are not increasing your speed. That means what? What are you doing there? When time moves, no distance has been changed. What kind of movement is there? What you will be doing when time alone goes?
Can you repeat, ma'am? Your voice was breaking.
My voice is breaking. Right. See, you are moving like this, okay, with a steady speed. And after some time, your time is only moving, but your distance is not moving or increasing. Okay, then what kind of motion you will be having here from this point?
We just stopped, ma'am.
Yes, you just stopped there. Okay, you're not
rest, moving. Ma'am.
Yes, correct. It is nothing but rest. Skanda, are you getting it? Skanda? Skanda, are you able to hear me? Skanda? Okay, right. So it is correct. Okay, so this is what a rest position is being maintained. And that is what stationary means. No movement is there. Stationary is another meaning is rest, resting or something like that. Okay, so this is what it is. And it is returning, returning while after some time, it is again going down. This means what? Your distance is reducing with your time. Okay, that means your speed is reducing here. So that is what this graph is meaning. Okay, it is an increasing speed. Okay, this is an increasing speed. And after some time, you are in rest and it is having a decreasing speed. So this is what this second graph means. And the third one, a curve shape is there, right? Okay, so when an object has a non-uniform speed, okay, that means you go different speed limits. See here, from this point to this point, there is something. From this point to this, again, another one. See how much distance it is. This is not same. And to this point, this is also not same. Okay, and to this is also not same. So like this, every point when I make it, okay, when I make it, every points are not following a correct path. Okay. Not equal distances are not there. Okay, that means it is a non-uniform motion. Either your time is changed or your distance is changed. So a curved path, if your curve shape is having in your graph, then you call it as a non-uniform speed or non-uniform motion. Right? Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Skanda, are you getting it clearly? Skanda, you just turn off your camera, Skanda, because yours is very poor. Okay, just turn off and turn on your mic and speak.
Ma'am, sometimes your voice is breaking, ma'am. Not now, but sometimes.
Sometimes my voice is also breaking. Okay.
But not now, ma'am.
Okay, Ananya. Right. So, I think, right. So, these are the three types of graphs. Okay, have you noted these graphs?
Yes, ma'am. Should I draw that, ma'am?
Yes, you should draw this.
I only wrote the table, ma'am.
No, you draw this also. This is also important. Okay,
ma'am.
Just a simple drawing. No, put one line like this, one line like this. Okay, a straight line. Mention the points. This is distance, okay, and this is time. And a line like this, and a line like this, okay, and mention them as.
Ma'am, we could just draw it roughly, ma'am.
Yes, you just draw it roughly. No problem. It is for your own seeing, right? You need to be very clear when you see the diagram.
Yes, ma'am.
Skanda? Skanda, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. Don't turn on your camera because your network is very shuffling. Okay. It's very shuffling. So you just take a screenshot of this. Okay. See, did you hear this third line when I'm saying, did you hear it? Did you hear it? What this graph is meaning? This curved line?
Should I write all those, ma'am, for study?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can write them also. See? Yes, Kanda?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So, see this. This is having a uniform speed. But when you see this, this is having a uniform speed. But your speed is increasing constantly. Okay, that also you can infer from this. See, in this point, this has traveled for some time distance and traveled this distance. And when I take some other points like this, I can tell that it is a fast, steady speed. Okay, it is a fast, steady speed it has been maintaining. And here, a steady speed is maintaining and stationary. And again, the returning to start point. Start point means the speed is reducing here. Okay, reducing.
Completely.
Right, okay. And here you see, when it is going up, okay, when it is, and the graph is starting from zero and going up, it means that it's going faster. When it is coming to zero, it means that is it is reducing. It is an increasing phase. This is in a reducing phase. Okay, these all you should be knowing. Okay, when you see this graph. Right, Skanda, you are getting clear? What is what and all?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay, we'll move further.
What and all I should write, ma'am?
You should write this
tabular.
Yeah, and also this graph. So you just take a screenshot and you copy it later.
I think he can't hear you, ma'am.
You couldn't hear me?
I no? can hear you, but I think he has some connectivity issues.
Still, right.
And now I can't hear you, ma'am.
Okay, Skanda, take a screenshot of this.
Yes, ma'am. 1 minute, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, to find the speed of a distance time graph. So now we saw that how your graph is there. Okay, how what kind of graph is making what kind of inference from that we can get. Everything we saw. So now, how you can calculate your speed exactly? Okay, from your graph. Okay, so speed is something is distance by time. Okay, and this distance is what your initial position and your final position, that is what the distance is, right? Okay, so even though when we had this, okay, these points will tell you you need this distance first and you need this time also. Okay, for this point you need this distance and this time also, then only you can make your calculation for your speed. But in another words, how we can tell this as, this is your initial point, this is your final point. And what you should do is, you should minus final point from your initial point. Okay. So that is what they are doing here. Final position of your object minus initial position, that will give you the distance. And time taken by the object. Here also time taken by the object to reach your final position from your initial position. That is what the time here means. Okay, so this formula is important. That means my distance will be d will be p2 minus p1. Like this, I can say this is my positions. Position 2 and this is my position 1. Okay, distance is nothing but change of position. So this change of position will give my distance. And time is same, okay? Whatever the time here, okay? And here, you need to measure the time here. So that will give you, when you divide them both, you will get your distance by time and the speed also. Right? Also, the speed of the distance time graph can be calculated by a slope of a graph, okay? So this, I'll tell you how. But before this, did you get clear with this point?
Yes, ma'am. I did not write it, ma'am.
Okay, you just write it down.
Can you show the previous slide?
Yeah.
Previous slide, ma'am?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. I have some. Yes, ma'am. You can change.
Okay.
We should write the 2 points, ma'am.
Yes, yes. These are all important ones you need to write. Okay, so now this is one way you can find your speed with just the positions, okay? But else you can also find it with the slope of a graph, okay? So slope is nothing but, okay, how much it has been, the slanting, okay, how much it has been inclined. That is what the slope is. And where, from that you can calculate your speed, okay? See, also the speed of the distance-time graph can be calculated by slope of a graph. The steeper the slope of the graph, the more is the speed of the object. For example, in the graph given below, object A has a steeper slope. This means the object A is moving at a higher speed than object B. So, see, this is the one steeper. See, this one is inclined to this, but steeper means it should be in 45 degrees, like not on the ground or not in this axis also, okay, in between that axis, okay, it is going through in between the axis, right? So then this is having a faster speed, it means, okay, this one, if I draw something like this, this will also much slower speed than this, okay? So this is the fastest among all these, okay? So and the in this way you can tell. Okay, anything that goes straight like this, this is the one which is faster. These two are not that much faster. How we can tell this means, see here, when this graph in this B, okay, it is covering it like this, okay? Lesser times, see, this is having some times is increasing, but distance covered is very less. Let's take this point as our, initial thing, okay? We are comparing them, okay? So then only you can tell this is faster than this, okay? We are comparing. So we'll find it out what are those 2 points at this edge, okay? What are the speeds there? So let's say this is having 10 minutes, okay? And this is having 6 meters, okay? Then what you'll do? 6 meter divided by 10. And you will be telling it as 0.6 meter per minute. This is what my speed is. Okay. We can write it in this way, right?
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yeah. Now I can hear you.
Okay, ma'am. You got stuck.
I got stuck. Right. Okay. See, if I am taking this as 10 and this as 6, this is the joining points, right? Okay,
yes.
So I have deduced my speed here by taking this time and this distance in account and 6 meter by 10 I put, and I am having 0.6 meter per minute. Now, let's go for A here. Okay, see, A is having some lesser time than 10. Okay, this B. That means it is having it in, let's say this is having it in 8, and but more distance, right? More distance means it is here. It can be here, like let's say this is 10, okay? And this one, this is your B, okay? And your A will be coming as 10 by 8, okay? And when you divide 10 by 8, what you will get? Okay, it will be something like...
Ma'am, we can't divide it. We should have the decimal.
Yeah, we can have the decimal here. When you do it in the decimal also, you'll get some 1.2 or something like that you will get. Meters per minute. I'm just dividing...
Or else we could do it, ma'am, but we'll get a reminder.
Yes, we'll get a reminder. But I'm just, you know, using that reminder also in this, and I'm writing it in a decimal form. Okay, I'm writing it in a decimal form. So you see here, this is my B and this is my A. Which is higher in these both?
Ma'am, A.
So, from this we can tell, right? The more steeper, the faster it goes.
Ma'am, A is faster because, ma'am, in 9 minutes, it's higher than B, ma'am. But in 10 minutes, it's low. B is lower than A.
Yeah, yeah. When you compare them. Okay. Ma'am. What, Skanda?
Ma'am, I think 10 divided by 8, ma'am.
10 divided by
8? It's, I think, 1.25, ma'am.
Okay, Skanda, okay. 1.25, let it be. You just need the first decimal point here. See, this is a zero, but this is one. One is bigger than zero, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So, this is the faster one. This is speeds. We calculated the speeds of A and B. So, and A is having this speed and B is having this speed. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm having Hindi class at 6 o'clock, ma'am.
Okay. We'll finish. That's all. Okay. For this class. Okay. So this is what your slope. Okay. From the slope or the steeper. Okay. Slope is nothing but how your graph has been inclined. Okay. The inclination, depending on the inclination, you can tell which is faster. These things and all. Right. Clear. Right.
Yes,
how
ma'am.
You can find everything. Okay. So, if we have questions on this means, you should answer. Skanda, you're clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, you just copy this. I think that's all. Yeah. Okay, we can end the session.
Yes, ma'am. 1 minute, ma'am.
Yeah.
1 minute, ma'am. Ma'am, yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, I'm writing.
Yeah, copy. Ma'am.
Completed, ma'am.
Okay. So this is all about your types of motion. Okay. So we are ending this unit here. Okay. So just go through them.
That's it, ma'am. The lesson got over.
Yes. The lesson got over.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So any doubts for you both?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
No? Okay, then. If no doubts means, we can end the session, kids.
Thank you, ma'am. Have a nice day.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, kids. Okay, we'll wait for a minute. Okay, then we'll begin the class. How was your Christmas celebrations and all in school?
It was good, ma'am.
You all had? Good?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. We had, ma'am. We wished each other, ma'am.
You had what?
Ma'am, we wished each other, ma'am. Some fun games and everything, ma'am.
Right, okay. Did you decorate and all?
Ma'am, no, ma'am. Not this year, ma'am. Because, like, we have, times, ma'am. Alternate days in a week and everything.
Right. Okay.
So, many of us didn't come because of this COVID situation, ma'am. Like, many of them. So, it was not that, like, the last another years, ma'am.
Not like a celebration?
Yes, ma'am. Not exactly like a celebration, ma'am.
Right. Nabil, for you, how it was?
School celebration, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was good, ma'am.
Right, okay. I think it's, no, today also, it's rare for people to join, I guess.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, Ashna.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Okay, students, we'll begin the class. A minute. Yeah. Okay, so today's class is of physics. What we had in the class, last class? Do people remember what we saw in the last class?
Force, ma'am.
Force, right? Yeah. Motion and pose, it was a chapter and we were in the force part. So you take your notes and all, we will start. Right, okay. Is my screen is visible for you?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay. I hope you remember the parts which we already saw. Okay, can you just recall them all? What and all we saw in the chapter of course?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, what are they? What were they? Each one can say a topic. Right, all forgot already.
These are types of forces.
Types of forces, right? So, what were the types of forces? Any examples about the types?
Ma'am, mechanical force.
Mechanical, right?
Frictional force, gravitational force, electrostatic force, magnetic force, and
yeah,
normal force, air yes. resistance force.
Yeah. Okay, good. So these many forces, types of forces we saw, and we saw about Newton's law, of course, right? Newton's laws in motion. We saw for about motion, how it will be, and what we had. Okay, so and we were seeing about the momentum and the apparent weight of a man inside a lift. So these are the topics which we saw about impulse and all. Okay, so now for today's class, we will continue with the force, inside force, what and all will be there. Okay, so now inertial mass. Okay, some term called as inertial mass. Where you have heard this inertia term?
Newton's first law.
Yeah, correct. Newton's first law, right? It talks about inertial motion. Okay, can anyone say what is inertial motion?
Ma'am, an object remains in a state of motion or rest until any further force acts on it, ma'am.
Yeah, and that state of or that property of that object, we tell it as the inertia. The property which that object in itself is having, that we call it as inertia, right? So now inertial mass. So this is also something related to your Newton's laws. Okay, how you can measure it. So it is defined as the ratio between the force to the acceleration A, a body, acceleration A, now this produced in the body. Okay, so it can be said like it is defined as the ratio between the force to the acceleration. We already know F is equal to ma is what your second law. Okay, from this only they have derived this. M, they kept M here and A has been brought down. So what this implies for us, see, when a body is having such a force and acceleration on it, okay, that will be equal to its mass. Okay, so that is what they are saying. And that is nothing but the inertial mass of that object. Or see, when the force is applied, how much it is accelerating, okay, or like with acceleration, how much force is there, and it is not together they are acting. Okay, it is division. So it means that how much it is resisting, kind of. So how much it is resisting, that will equal to your mass. So that is what this equation implies us. Okay, we need to understand this. And when the velocity of the body is comparable to the velocity of light, okay, when the body's velocity is now reaching the light velocity, okay, your inertial mass changes with velocity in accordance with the following formula. Okay, so this changes, your inertial mass will take this kind of equation or this kind of changes in it. Okay, what is the light speed?
3 into 10 to the power of 8 meter per second.
Yeah, correct. So 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second is what is C here. Okay, your C is nothing but your speed of light, and this is your speed of the object. So when it nears or comparable to your speed of light, then your inertial mass should be like this. So that is what they are saying. And this MI naught, okay, I zero, they are told, they have mentioned there, it is nothing but MI naught. And every time when there is a knot means that is called as when it is in the rest position or the initial position, there only you'll go. So this is a rest mass of the body. Okay, when it is in the rest, how much mass it can have. And this inertial mass is when it is having some velocity. So V is the velocity of the body and C is the velocity of light. Okay, so what will happen? So this is some description they have given, but actually what will happen when a body is traveling in a speed of light? Can anyone say or anyone know, read about that? Because light speed is very fast, okay, and from this you can say that, see, this A is nothing but a derivation of velocity, okay, and it is seriously affecting your mass. That is what they are saying with this. Okay, so what will happen if your velocity is increased? multifold, okay, and how it will affect your mass.
My mass decreases if acceleration increases, ma'am.
Yeah, mass decreases when acceleration increases, right? So acceleration nothing but your change in your velocity, okay? So it is kind of like that, okay? Body which is having mass can't travel in the velocity of light, okay? That means when a body is traveling, it will elongate. Okay, when that is traveling in the light speed, when it reaches to light speed, it will elongate. The length will be more, okay? And your mass can't be contained there, okay? And how it will become means it will become infinite. Your mass will become infinite. That means you can't know what is your mass itself. That is what infinite means. Okay, it will become infinite. But your mass can't be infinite. So whatever the known mass subjects can't travel in light speed. If this is a fact. So if we can travel in light speed means that is not a possible thing. Okay, for now. So that is what our physical facts for this now, for this time, whatever the facts on what basis of physics is there, that says it can't be possible. Okay, so that is what it says. So this is what will happen when you are traveling in a light speed. Okay. So this is about your inertial mass. Okay, clear with inertial mass all.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. Okay. So we'll move. Now, next thing is conservation of your linear momentum. So what is momentum? What is momentum? What? No one remembers.
Power is equal to mass into velocity.
Power is equal to mass into velocity. Okay. Was that power, Gopika?
Particle.
Ma'am, it's momentum equal to mass into velocity, ma'am.
Right. This tells that no one have listened in the last class properly, right? P is a symbolization of momentum. Okay, anywhere you go, momentum will be mentioned with P.
Sorry, ma'am. That time I didn't note it down.
Right. Okay, just note it down now. Okay, so P is momentum. Okay, so this is a linear momentum. Okay, so we are talking about linear momentum. That means linear flow will be there. The distance as you are traveling, that will be a linear motion. Okay, that is what it means about linear momentum. So conservation of linear momentum. What is conservation here?
Ma'am, like converting, ma'am?
No, not converting. What is the meaning of conservation?
I'm saving, ma'am.
Saving, kind of, right? Conserving. You need to conserve your forest. This is a word most of the times you'll be hearing, right? Your life, wildlife creatures, conserve wildlife, nature, everything you'll be hearing. So conservation is kind of protecting or safeguarding, preserving. So that is what your conservation means. So conservation of linear momentum in a system. So that is what we are going to see now. So what is they have given here is in an isolated system, no external force. Okay, that means no external force has been acting on that system. Isolated, completely isolated system. The algebraic sum of the momentum of bodies along any straight line remains constant and is not changed due to their mutual action and reaction on each other. Okay, so what this says is the algebraic sum of the momentum of bodies, okay, algebraic sum of means nothing but the addition. Okay, momentum of bodies means there is a closed system. Let's say this is a system and it is having multiple particles. Each will have a separate masses, and every masses and with some velocity they are traveling. Okay, and they'll produce the momentum there. So the this, let's say this is having P1, this is having P2, this is having P3. All these momentums addition. Okay, so this is what they're saying. The algebraic sum of the momentum of bodies along any straight line. That means a straight line. So in this way, the momentum of the bodies remains constant. That means between them, there is no change. It is maintaining a constant part there. Okay, so that is what it means. Remains constant and is not changed due to their mutual action and reaction on each other. When momentum becomes constant, your force will become zero. Okay, so this is what it means. I hope we already saw that for force. Right. How we can say this means? I think we already have seen this. F is equal to ma, right? So ma is nothing but a is nothing but dv by dt. Okay, so this is what your a is. Okay, and so I can substitute this. That means that. Okay, so you can represent it with P also. And the MV, if I take, okay, let's say this M into DV by DT or MV divided by T will be coming. So it is P by T. So this is what your force is. Okay, so in this way we can say, or else, okay, we can term them in P also, that is momentum also. So what I did here is, see, F is equal to ma, ma is nothing but v by t. Okay, or in this place we don't need the d also. No, for our convenience we'll just remove this d also here. Okay, so with time, just okay, with time your velocity changes are there. So m into v by t you can put, and mv is nothing but your momentum. So momentum by time, okay, rate of change of momentum it is. So this is what EF is. So you can tell that if P becomes zero or P becomes constant, or if I say dP by dt, okay, if this is the case, means if this becomes constant, okay, your F will become zero. Else I'll write it and show you in a screen, then it'll be clear. See, what I've written here is, how I'm telling that it becomes zero means, your F is equal to ma, this we know, okay, change in momentum is, rate of change of momentum is what your dp by dt is what your force, this is from your second law of motion, okay. So from this only we have derived this F is equal to ma, so dp by dt it is, right. So in integration, so this is a differentiation, okay, how we can write is P2 minus P1 and divided by T2 minus T1. Okay, this equation can be written in this way. Okay, can you get it how I am writing this equation?
Mom, you can repeat again, mom.
Yeah, see, I'm taking my Newton's second law. Okay, second law that says F is equal to ma, or rate of change of momentum. Okay, in the previous class I told you, right, rate of change of anything, like that means it is divided by dp, rate of change of, okay, dp by dt you can write, that is nothing but your final momentum minus initial momentum. That is what I've written here. This P2 can be taken as my final momentum. This P1 can be taken as my initial momentum. This is final and this is initial. Okay, and also T2 is my final time and this is my initial time. Okay, So this is what this dp by dt means, okay, rate of change of. So here you see, I can write it in this form. Okay. With this, all are getting right how I'm writing this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now you see, okay, I'm telling that your momentum is, okay, in a linear way. So now we'll come to the conservation of linear momentum. Okay. This is my system. And this is one straight line. Here multiple particles are there and all are having, you know, momentum. Okay. They are having P1, P2, P3 as like this. Okay. And they are having constant momentums. Constant momentums means all are P1 is equal to P2. P2 is equal to P3. So like this. This is what constant, right? Constantly it is there. Okay. Constant means same repetition. Okay. No changes in that. So this is what constant means. So in a linear system, your momentum will become constants. Okay. And see, this P1 is equal to P2 and P2 is equal to P3. And so it will go for every particle in the straight line. And see, if I use this formula, this equation in this place, what will happen?
Zero, ma'am.
Zero.
Yeah. Correct. Okay. So your F will become zero, nothing but zero. That is what they are saying. Okay. So no force will be exhibited from that system. Okay. So that means your no external force is also there. And from that place also, no force will be gone out. Okay. It won't go out. So that is what. Okay, your conservation of linear momentum. Your force won't be gone out and come in. Okay, and that is your momentum will be constant throughout the system. So this is what your conservation of linear momentum. Your momentum will be conserved inside the system itself. No lose or no gain. Okay, so we can say that when no lose or no gain is there, okay, only shifting is there. Okay, you can say this universe as an example for this. Okay, conservation of linear momentum is also conservation of energy. Okay, like that only it is. For conservation of energy, we have this popular term, right? Energy neither can be created nor can be destroyed. It can only change from one state to another state.
Law of conservation of mass.
Law of conservation of mass? Law of conservation of energy, right? It is.
Ma'am, mass can neither be created nor be destroyed in a chemical reaction. It's law of conservation of mass.
Okay, law of conservation of mass. Okay, right. So it applies for energy also. Okay. Like mass is what energy is. Okay, so you can compare them. So on that basis only, okay, it is like the same. Your momentum will be conserved inside an isolated system. So your F will become zero inside them. No force exchange will be happening there also. Okay. So this is what your conservation of linear momentum is. Okay. You can, we can see some examples also later. Okay. So till this, you are clear, right? How F is becoming zero. That is no exchange of forces is happening.
Ma'am, could you explain it another time, ma'am?
From the first? Okay. You just copy this slide. Okay, I'll go for the slides now.
Completed, ma'am.
Right. Everyone completed? Shall we move?
Yes, ma'am.
Completed.
Completed, ma'am.
Okay. So, right. So, here you see, now going for your conservation of linear momentum. So, now read this, okay? In an isolated system, the algebraic sum of the momentum of bodies along any straight line remains constant and does not change due to their mutual action and reaction on each other. This is what they are saying. Okay. So that is what I've also told you from that. It means that no force change will be there. Okay. So no external force will also apply. Okay. And all the momentum's addition will be constant and not changed. Okay. Even between them, inside them, there can be any kind of reactions. Okay. Any kind of motions in between them. But that won't affect the external things out of that system. So whatever the changes are there, the momentum or the force, okay, that won't go out unless or until an external force is applied to them. Okay, so that is what a conservation of linear momentum is. We'll see some of the facts later. Okay, so that is what I told you. Okay, and how that force will is becoming zero, that I mentioned through the constant, no, the momentum becoming constant. When the momentum becomes constant, your force will become zero. For that to mean, no, to explain that only, I've gone to the screen. Okay, so that case is clear, right? How it becomes zero for you all?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, see, we'll move for to the next slide and we'll see more. Okay, see, conservation of momentum. Okay, what this concept says is part of the universe chosen for analysis is called a system. That means something, okay, you're taking and that you're calling it as system in this universe. Like a solar system in the is a part of this universe. Or you take a cycle of a system, like, you know, a mosquito becoming, you know, from the larva to mosquito, that is a system. Okay, any part you are taking, that you call it as a system. Everything outside the system is called an environment. These are some basic terms. So for example, a car moving with constant velocity can be considered a system. All the forces within the car are internal forces, and all forces acting on the car from the environment are external forces like friction. Okay, so internal force and external forces are these. Okay, inside the system, whatever the forces are happening, like inside your body, whatever the things are happening, those are all internal. And if whatever the outside factors that is affecting or that is coming into your body's action, that you call it as external. Okay. Now, conservation of momentum. The total momentum of an isolated body is conserved. That means it is all inside only, total momentum. So that is what they are meaning here. So isolated systems, net external force on the system will be zero. Okay. A system is like this. Okay. That, yeah, its momentum is conserved inside that. Okay. And no external force will be acting there. So that is, external force is zero on that system, on that particular system. Okay. This is what conservation of momentum is. A concept it is. Okay. Example, they are telling that collision of two balls. Okay. A and B. So A and B are the balls being collided. Okay. What happens is the forces. Okay. Inside this, let's say this are the A and B. Okay. So this is colliding into this, okay, this whole is a system, if I'm taking, means whatever the force this A is having, that will be transferred to this B, okay, completely it will transfer to this B, and no, you know, unless or until any other forces not deriving anything from them, like friction or like other air resistance, like that, no external force is there, okay, the whole force of this A will be transferred to this B. So this is what your conservation of linear momentum. All those forces, all those momentum in this A will be transferred to this B. All conserved, it will be transferred to this B. So that is what your conservation of linear momentum is. Okay. So no derailation of any forces will happen unless or until another external force is acting on them. Okay. Clear somewhat? What is conservation of linear momentum?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, for everyone or any doubt speaking now?
No doubts, ma'am.
No doubts? Okay. So, Right. So, yeah. So here you see the force of A will be conserved. Okay. If the force is again redirecting from B to A, then it will be minus F. Okay. If it is redirecting in this way, then it will be minus F. The force will be because of this direction. Okay. And that you call it as, for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction like that. Okay. Right. So this is what your conservation of linear momentum. So now, recoiling of gun. So this we already saw in what?
Newton's third law.
Yes, Newton's third law only we saw this recoiling of gun. And what happens there? Okay. So if M is the mass of the bullet, M is the mass of the gun, okay, the capital M, and V is the mass of the bullet, okay, V is the velocity. Then velocity of the recoiling of the gun, V will be, capital V will be equal to, V is equal to minus of M by M it is, okay. So nothing but your velocity with this will be negative of this, okay. Your momentum will be negative, okay. Your whatever the capital V is for the gun, right, and the mass is for the gun. So whatever the gun is having, okay, whatever the momentum this gun is producing in the front, that will be recoiled at the back also, okay. A kind of similar momentum will be recoiled in the back also from the bullet. Okay. So the recoiling of gun's momentum will be equal to the bullet's momentum also. Okay. And that will be the recoiling of the gun will be on your shoulder, and the momentum that is facing the bullet, it will be forward. Okay. So in that way only they are saying that V is equal to, you can find the velocity of the recoil of the gun, how much velocity it has, pushing you with, okay, that you can find it with this formula they are saying, okay, just a simple formula. But what you can infer from this formula is that your recoiling of gun, okay, whatever the momentum that is happening, okay, that will be equal to your, but in the opposite direction, of course, it will be equal to the bullet's momentum. Okay, so that is what your recoiling of gun says. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear, ma'am.
Clear, okay. Just take a note simultaneously. Did you all copy the previous slide? Anyone missed?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay. So the next thing is equilibrium of concurrent forces, okay. So how these concurrent forces are there? What are these? What is concurrent or concurrency?
Ma'am, which have same size and same angle, the measurement will be same.
Measurement will be same. Was that concurrency? Concurrency, I'm asking, what is concurrency?
Ma'am, acting in the same point, ma'am.
Yeah, something acts at the same point, concurrence, meeting at the same point or intersection, okay, like this. Here it says that, right? So anything that is meeting like this, this is what concurrency, crossing the same line, okay. So how does this maintain equilibrium of concurrent forces? So if concurrent forces are there, means how their equilibrium will be. Equilibrium is what?
Ma'am, balanced.
Balanced, right? Okay, equilibrium is nothing but equally balanced one. That is what we'll tell it as equilibrium, and that will be employed in some reactions and some systems. Okay, that term will be employed there. Okay, so now forces are said to be concurrent if they meet at a common point. Okay, so this is what the concurrency of forces. Okay, whatever the forces are meeting at the same point, then we call them as concurrent forces, okay. And okay, some points are missing, I guess. Okay, so all these forces will be, after meeting, it will be settled down. Okay, everything will be settle down as it is, okay, it will maintain an equilibrium thereafter. Till then, if they are in the different way means, okay, different, let's say, Newton, that is right, force. So different Newtons it is having, but at the concurrency point, okay, when they meet, okay, everything will be shared equally and it will become equilibrium at that point. So this is what concurrent forces is, okay, right? So this is what concurrent force. Then the next thing is moment of the force, okay? So moment of the force is nothing but in a line of action at that particular moment, what is the force? So that is what moment of force is. Okay, simple word for that, moment of forces at the particular distance. Okay, what is the forces? And we call it as yeah, this is what moment of force. Okay, F is the force and D is the distance of the line of action. So let's say that F is the force that is here and this is the line of action it is making, okay? That we call that force making that action, we call it as moment of force, okay? So this is what moment of force is. And momentum of a couple, the next one is. So that we are calling it as torque, momentum of couple. So before knowing about momentum of a couple, we should be knowing what is a couple itself. Okay, anyone has any idea about couple? No, haven't heard about them?
Mom, two, mom.
Two. Okay, couple, right. Okay,
so here, equal and unequal parallel forces.
Yeah, right. Okay, that is what couple is. Okay, so in this physics terms, okay, you call couple as two. Okay, that is nothing but two only, but two equal and opposite forces. Okay, two equal, opposite, and parallel forces acting about, you know, a same point or a same line, let's say, okay? Because they are about the same point or line, so anything that can be told, okay? But the forces are, you know, acting about something and they are, those two forces are opposite. So let's say if this force is like this, means this force will be in this way. Okay, so like that it will be moving and they are equal. Okay, also they are equal and they are parallelly moving. Okay, not any in this direction or like that. Okay, they are parallelly moving. So this is what a couple is. Okay, where you can find this couple means any action like this. Okay, so that you call it as couple. So what kind of action here this can have? What kind of examples this action can have?
Turning a tap, ma'am.
Turning a tap. Okay, right. Anything else? Any else points?
Spinning of a top.
Spinning of a top. Yeah. Spinning of a top, you can tell. Yeah.
I'm opening a water bottle cap.
Yes, okay. So these are some examples of your couple. Okay, now that you could easily get it, I guess. So if this is a case, means these are the two forces acting on the point. So one force will be like this and another force will be like this. So that will create a turning effect for me. Okay, a turning effect. So momentum of couple or moment of couple. Okay, so that we call it as torque, okay, a turning effect. Or else I can tell it as a turning effect because of this. Okay, because of this couple, a turning effect will be there, and that momentum of couple, I'm calling it as torque. And what is this momentum of couple itself? Because couple is not torque. Okay, couple is just two simple forces which are opposite and equal and parallel. But what is this momentum of couple? Momentum of couple is equal to the product of the force and the perpendicular distances between them. That means whatever the force is, okay, you take this one force along with you take this direct this length also, okay? So from about what point it is turning, from that point, okay, whatever the distance is perpendicular from the point, okay, or equal to the product of the force and the perpendicular distance are between them. So let's say this is the distance between them, okay, between those two forces. So just the force, it is called couple, okay? This is nothing but the force, but with along with the distance, okay, along with the distance, we call it as the momentum of couple, and that is called as torque. So torque is an important word here, okay? Torque applies great significance in physics. So torque is nothing but R vector into F vector, okay? Do you know about vectors? What is vector?
Mom, about magnitude and direction.
Yes, like, okay. Yeah, right. Okay. So when it is both having magnitude and also it says about the direction on which it is moving, okay, that you call it as, okay, vector. And here you can see that here in the R and F vectors are acting, okay, in what direction your R vector is there and in what direction your F is moving, okay, along with its magnitude, that you multiply it, okay, put a cross between them, okay, cross multiply them, then you get the torque, okay? So vector product of R and F will give you the torque, okay? So this is what momentum of couples. So what we can tell again is when an object is there, let's see, this is my object, okay, and here one force is applied and it's in this direction. So this is a whole object and here one force is there and that is being acting in this direction, okay? This is an object about this point and it will start to move now, okay? And this distance, okay, this distance, I call it as the distance, okay, between them. Together with that, okay, when this is moving, okay, it produces a torque in this object, okay? So any spinning object will have this torque, okay? It's nothing but the turning effect. Okay, so clear with torque concept?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, any doubts till this part? No, right?
No, ma'am.
Right, okay. So moving on now. So what next we can say is work done by a couple. So how we can tell work done, how we can describe work done first?
Ma'am, time into force, ma'am.
Time into force. Time into force means, see, that is impulse, right? So whatever time you are giving that force, that you call it as impulse, how much time you are giving. But here work is done. How you call work is done in a system?
Force into displacement.
Yes. Okay. So in normal terms, you tell work is something. Okay. It is force into displacement or displacement like this, okay? So force into displacement is what work is. Consider a table is being pushed, okay? Unless or until the distance is there, okay? You call it as a work is done there, okay? If distance is not there, just simply the force is being applied, there is no work has been done. That is what you call, okay? So work done means force plus the displacement is that it has made, okay, the object has made. So that you call it as work done. And here for a, okay, something like this, this is my object which is having a force like this. Okay, it is having a torque. Okay, so this object is having torque, nothing but a torque. So now how my work done can be calculated from this? Okay, so how we can calculate this means it is with the angular displacement theta. Okay, so if this is a circular path, okay, so or else how we can say, let's say that my object is there. Okay, this is an object, or we can say, okay, any force, okay, along with a distance, along with the point from it, okay, to opposite distance, that we call it as torque. With that you will be clear. Okay, here when coming to this couple, work done by the couple or work done in a torque. Okay, so how we can tell it means with the angular displacement it is making. Here angular displacement is something, initially it will be in some angle. Okay, whenever there is a turn, okay, whenever there is a circular motion, okay, that is what here happens. Turning effect is nothing but a circular motion. Okay, it will produce, okay, you should, okay, whenever there is a turning motion, you should start to compare them with a circle or a protractor. So that will have degree radian changes in them. Okay, so that you'll have rotational motion. Okay, here rotational motion will be having, and it will definitely have a radian changes in them for their movement. Every movement here, displacement is something taken in radians. That is nothing but theta. Okay, so that is what they have done here. Okay, usually your work done is force into displacement, but here force is nothing but the torque. Okay, so this torque is what the turning effect, otherwise you call it the force in a rotating object, and this theta is the distance or the angle in this case it is making. So let's say initially let be a particle here, and after some turning effect has been given, the particle has moved to this place inside that object, then it will have a theta here. Okay, so that is the radian it has been moved. Okay, so any distances here can be made, that is through this rotational field. Okay, so that is what this theta means here, and that is my angular displacement. Okay, this is a displacement, but is an angular displacement which makes an angle. Okay, so theta is an angular displacement equals to the displacement in this case. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is what your work done in the case of a rotational motion. Okay, so you'll be very, very much clear when you go for 11th standard, you'll study more about this. Okay, so now it's fine for you to go along with this much points. Okay, now when it is a connected motion, like a pulley problem is coming. Okay, so you see here there are two pulleys. So here is also the same torque is there. Okay, where my torque is applied here? Like in this picture, in what place my torque is being applied?
Ma'am, the two wires are joined to the circle, no, ma'am? That two points, ma'am.
Okay, here you are saying this point.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah, it is correct. And the torque is applied in this, this one. The rotating pillar is there, right? The pulley formation. Okay, this one is what is having the reaction. 1 minute, please. So, see, so this is where my torque is applied. Okay, whenever we are going for a rotational motion, there your force will be termed as torque. Okay, and the torque will be represented like this. Okay, the symbol is nothing but tau symbol. Okay, you call it as tau, the symbol. But most of the time it is used for torque. So you need not to know about this tau also. So most of the time it will be mentioned as, whenever this symbol is coming, it just signifies that there is a torque. Okay, so forces will be a torque whenever it is a rotational motion. And your displacement will be angular displacement theta. Okay, these terms you need to remember. So now coming to this pulley thing. Okay, so here only my torque will be applied. So obviously some forces being acting on the top and on the bottom, okay, in this direction and this direction also. So what we can infer from here, okay? So driven by a body moving vertically, right? So if my body is moving vertically like this, so to some object here, mg is there, that is, this is having this mass and this one is having a bigger mass, okay? So this mass will start to pull this mass in this direction, okay, which is vertical motion. Okay, so in this case, how you can solve these problems, okay, when the questions are being asked, what is this acceleration, what is the tension of the string is here. Okay, so those things only you will be getting for a pulley thing. Okay, so when we talk about a pulley, okay, whatever we can do here is acceleration of the system we can find from this pulley. Okay, so this is the system and it is the acceleration of the system we need to find. So to what acceleration we'll be finding? Can anyone say?
Ma'am, you can repeat again.
Yeah, so here I am telling that acceleration we'll find. So to what the acceleration can be found in this system?
Ma'am, can't understand the question.
I couldn't understand the question. Okay. To understand the question, you should be knowing that acceleration is what? Acceleration can be found for some objects, right? So acceleration is something which is the change of speed, okay, or or with the force and the mass, okay? So that with that also you can tell acceleration is nothing but F by M it is, okay? In this way you can tell. So this is what acceleration is. And here we can tell it for a body. But here what we are doing is we are finding this acceleration for the whole system itself. Okay, depending upon this two masses. Okay, so whichever the mass is more greater, for that acceleration will be more. And towards that only the acceleration will be acting. Okay, so that is what this system's acceleration means here. Okay, this acceleration will be individual, and this for this one's acceleration will be individual. Okay, so acceleration is something which you find out for knowing at what rate it is moving with time. So that is what it is. So with mass, if it is provided, means you can find it separately for each of the body with just mass and the gravitation and the force which has been acted on them. So here we can find M and M, the acceleration. Let's say this is small acceleration, this is the for this acceleration. Okay, we can find. But for going for the whole of a system, okay, that is what mentioned here also, acceleration of the whole system. When you go to find an acceleration of the whole system, okay, what will happen means whatever the acceleration are there, as they are being, you know, opposite to each other, okay, they'll cancel, and the rest which is having more acceleration will be the system's acceleration also. So that is what the system's acceleration means here. And you can see the equation here that says that m minus m divided by m plus m into g. Okay. So this is what it is says. Acceleration nothing but mass into the gravitation. Okay. So the F by M. So whatever the force is being there, those forces will get cancelled here. And so it will remain with the mass changes, okay? Whatever the differences in the mass, that will contribute for your acceleration then. So see here, mass, the one's mass divided by the other one and total mass they are dividing and multiply it with the G, okay? So that will give you the acceleration of the whole system. Why they are taking this for the whole system? Because after doing everything, okay, the remaining will be the one that is greater here. Okay, that will give you the whole system's acceleration also. But individually, it will have acceleration. To say, it will have individual acceleration. The whole system won't have acceleration. Okay, it won't move the whole system. But when you say acceleration of the system, the one which is having more acceleration will remain for your system's acceleration. So that is what I am meaning here also. Okay. So this is what this acceleration of the system will give you at last. Are you people getting it? What I'm meaning? A bit confused still. Yes, kids, say something. Did you understood or not?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah?
Ma'am, I have a doubt, ma'am.
Yeah?
Ma'am, you have written that small e and capital E, ma'am.
Yeah?
Their acceleration will be different or same, ma'am?
They'll be different only because acceleration is dependent on your mass, right?
No.
So your mass determines your acceleration also. It's a factor also for your acceleration. So it will be different for them.
Yes.
Right. So this is what about your acceleration in this system, okay? And you can have some other formulas for the system to find the tensions also, okay? So just see that what we are doing is we are having a system there and this system can be taken for your, you know, force application. Okay, this is nothing but the forces application here. And from this system, what we can infer is what we are seeing. The first thing which we saw is the acceleration of the system. And the second is the tension we are going to see about. How the tension will be there. And this tension is something which will be having in the strings only. Okay, in these strings only, we can have this tensions. So how this tension will be there for your system. Okay, and the next one is the force on the pulley. How the force will be. So everything dependent on the known mass. Okay, which we are finding now. So this is what we are doing here. Okay, kids.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so for acceleration, this is a formula that is m minus m, small m, divided by m plus m into g. And to find the tension of the string, okay, your formula is having the string's tension will be dependent on both of these masses. Okay. So it will depend on both of these masses. And so it is having 2 into mm, both of these masses divided by m plus m. And to the gravitational force. Okay. So everything here will be multiplied with gravitational force because it is all this g will be acting on them when it is moving vertically. Okay. So that is why this G is applied here. So you just copy this one. That is the tension in the string will be 2 into the mass of the smaller one, the mass of the bigger body divided by the both of the masses addition into the gravitational force. Okay. So with this, the tension of the string will be calculated. tension is nothing but the pressure being exerted from that string, or the force, some kind of force being exerted from that string. Okay, so that depends on both of these masses. That is what they are telling here. Okay, and the force on the pulley. So here, the in this part only, the force is acting on this pulley. Okay, and how that force will be there? That force will also depend on the masses, and that will be 4 times of your tension on the string. Okay, the forces will be 4 times of the string over this, because on one part also there is a string, and on the other part also there is a string being connected to the pulley. So both will act, and it will be 4 times of your tension of the string. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. Then the same cases when it is in a driven in a horizontal friction is happening. Okay, when it is in the horizontal way, the pulley is going. So driven body moving horizontally, how your acceleration will be. See, acceleration of the system here changes like capital M divided by M plus M only. So here your small m doesn't play much of the role when it is for acceleration. Why so? Anything that you are able to analyze here?
Can you repeat again, ma'am?
Yeah. So we are seeing about this driven body moving horizontally, right? So here the acceleration is given like capital M divided by M plus M into G. Okay. So this is what my acceleration is. So this acceleration just directly depends on your capital M that is being hung here. Okay. Your small m is in a horizontal platform. Okay. So here something is just with the M only the acceleration is taken. So why this is happening here? That is what I'm asking here. Why we are not taking my, taking our small M in this place?
Ma'am, that acts as a force that drives it.
What, Vidula?
That acts as the force, ma'am, that drives it horizontally.
This is acting as a force, you are saying.
Ma'am, the bigger M, ma'am. That acts as a force.
Okay, and so the acceleration just depends on this, you are saying.
Yes, ma'am, maybe, ma'am.
Yeah, okay, so that is one case, okay. And also you see here, there is a force being acted upon here, okay. There will be a frictional force which is, which will cut down all these forces also here. Okay, whatever the force is created, the force is only created by this entity here. And so, as Vidula said, the force will be solely depending on this. And here also, whatever the force that is being acting in this point, okay, that will be cut down with the frictional force and it will become zero. And so the acceleration at this point will not be there. So it will solely depend on this. But the mass can contribute to this. That's why your acceleration is having just M by M plus M. Okay, it solely depends on this point over here. Okay, so this is what acceleration is. And to the tension, okay, so it's the same case as this, but here there is no, like the tension is only at this point, okay, not in this point. So that's why, because your even your force is acting in this way, okay, your acceleration is solely depend on this force only. So there is no tension in this point. So it is just M into M by M plus M into G. Okay. And the force on the pulley here. Okay. This pulley's force will be root 2 of M by M, M plus M into G. Right. So this one, this root 2 is something because of this angle it is being made here. Okay. So this is not fully explainable for you. Just you get it, like because of this angle made here, this root 2 has come, okay? this force is just on this place. Okay, so that's why just root 2 is being here because of this angle being made by this pulley. So root 2 of m by m divided by m plus m into g will give you the force when it is in a horizontal movement. Okay, the force on the pulley. Okay, so you people just take notes of these all formulas. Okay, we can work out some problems later. Okay, everyone finish this slide?
Just a minute.
Yeah.
Completed.
Okay. Right, so next one. Right, so now we'll see about application of Newton's third law when it is in the contact of two blocks. Okay, how would this is acting on? Okay, we already have discussed about this. Okay, like conceptually we discussed and how it can be formulated, we'll see now. So acceleration of a body is something here. See this picture, here is what we are getting this. So force is being applied here to this object. And the force will be acting to this point. So, right. So this will be acting from, let's say this is one point and this is two. Or, yeah. So this is the force, okay, which is acting towards 2, 1. And this is 1, 2, okay, in this direction it is. So when two blocks are in contact with each other, and it will be exhibiting some force towards both the sides opposite to them and with equal number of Newton. Okay, so it will be equal forces, but will be in the opposite directions. And how we can tell that in the acceleration means, your whatever the force you are giving, that will be added upon with this. So that is what the force has been given here. Okay, the F force is being given here. So the force will be equal to, or the acceleration that happens here. Okay, the moment after the force being applied and that object being moved, that acceleration will depend upon both the masses, and you need to add upon these two masses also. So that is what the acceleration will be when two bodies in this contact. And if not for this external force, what will happen for this body's their own forces? Okay, because of this contact, okay, the force in between them will be acting equally and oppositely to each other. So that is what here is. So from 1, 2, so this is the 1, 2 point. This is 1, 2 in this direction, and 2, 1, or like you can say this in this way. So this is 2, 1. So it will be in this direction. That is what here 1, 2, and 2, 1 means. 1, 2 will be in this direction, and 2, 1 will be in this direction, opposite direction. But they will be the same force. And this contact force F12 will be M by M plus M into F it will be. So we are just doing that. Okay. So what we are doing is F12 is equal to F21, and that will be equal to your force multiplied with this mass. Okay, right. So how you can find this force means, okay, this force will be dependent on this mass divided by the multiplication addition of these masses with the external force. Okay, whatever the external force is given, okay, that force will be that force multiplied with the, okay, this force is See, this force is inversely proportional to m by m. Okay, so that's why m plus m is in the down. Okay, that's it is division. Okay, and that force will be equal to whatever the force is being reverted back from this mass. Okay, so and so this mass will be taken here. So the force applied to this one will be reverted back. So that mass. So together with this, the whole force will be there. So that will be the F12 and F21, but it will be in the opposite direction for both of them. Okay. So the magnitude when we see, so this will be equal to this. F into mass of the small one divided by together them. Okay. So the whatever the force you apply, that force will be acting with the mass here. Okay. That will be equal to the F21 also, the force in the other side also. So this is what your contact force is. Okay, so everyone getting this, what is contact force from this?
Can you repeat, ma'am?
Yeah, okay. So here, contact force is nothing but about how your force will be there, okay? So you need to know the concept regarding this only. So how you can find the acceleration of this contact force along with these two masses and how the forces will be upon them. It will be of opposite and equal, and the how the contact force will be. Okay. In this point, how the contact force will be, let's say this F12 that is being exerted from this point. Okay. That will depend on the masses and the force being applied on them. Okay, and that will be the magnitude of the force will be equal to, okay, equal on either side. So that is what here we saw already. Okay, F12 is equal to F21. Okay, but it will be in the opposite direction, just this minus will be there here. Okay, that is what I showed here. Okay, so minus will be produced here, and it will be depending on the masses of them together with whatever force you are applying. Okay, so this is what contact force is. Okay, if you're not clear, means in the next class I'll tell you with a bit more explanation also. Okay, if it is clear, it's fine. Do you need some more explanation for this?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay. In the next class, we'll see. We'll complete about the friction today. And in the next class, we'll see some other topics. So together, I'll tell you about this more in the next class, okay? So now, coming for the friction part. So friction is something which we already saw. Whenever a body tends to slide over another surface, so some opposing force will be exhibited from the surface, okay? So that force is called as friction, or the force of friction. Okay. So this force acts tangentially to the interface of two bodies. So tangentially means, so if this is the surface, okay, so this will be acting tangentially to the surface like this. Okay. So this is something tangentially touching like this it will be. So for a circle, you will be putting a tangent like this, right? So the same thing here, okay? It will be tangentially playing here, opposing, and it will be an opposing force. Whatever the force is your body is having, it will be an opposing force there. So this is what frictional forces, or force of friction, you'll say. Okay, so which we already saw. And there are types of friction, okay? There are static friction, right, and some more are there. Okay, we'll see what are they. So now, static friction is the force of friction between two surfaces so long as they are in no relative motion between them. So when those two forces are just stationary, when those two objects are just stationary, some kind of frictional force will be exhibiting. That force you call it as static friction when there is a no relative motion is there. Okay, relative motion is something with the surface and the object. okay, relatively. So that for that motion is not there, and so it is having a static friction just because of staying in that surface. So yeah, in this way you can understand it is always equal to the applied force. Okay, so the static force are incorporated in the following inequality. So how it can be told means, so your static friction will be lesser than equal to mu n. See whether they have explained here. Right. So your mu s is nothing but your coefficient of kinetic energy, and n is the normal force. So how they are saying it as, okay, the static frictional force are incorporated in the following inequality. So they can be told like this, because always a normal force is what will be exerted, right? When it is static, we always studied about normal force being exerted there. So it will be equal to that, but a coefficient of friction will be applied there, because when we are talking about frictional force, okay, so that kind of entity should be there. So it will be lesser than or equal to normal. Okay, it can't be more than the normal force, but it can be lesser than or equal to. How we'll see now. Okay, did you copy this, everyone?
No, just a minute.
Yeah.
Ma'am, 1 minute, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I'll complete it, ma'am. I'll write it, ma'am.
Okay, then complete it. I'll change the slide.
Done, ma'am.
Okay, so everyone copied?
Completed, ma'am.
Right, okay. So now, right, the magnitude of the static friction has a maximum value. So that will be when it is equal to the normal force with the coefficient there. Okay. So here they are saying that inequality, how it will be means, it will be lesser than or equal to. Your static friction won't be greater than your normal friction, because normal friction is something just exhibiting to equal to whatever the force or whatever the, let's say it's mg, right? So that body is having equal and opposite will be the normal force. But static friction will be lesser or it can be equal. So static friction will be maximum when it is equal to your normal friction. So that is what they are given here. Okay, when it is maximum, okay, so that will be equal to your normal friction, normal force. And the coefficient of static friction can be written in this way. Okay, it is nothing but your frictional force to your normal force. Okay, frictional force maximum to your normal force, if you are taking, means your coefficient will be a ratio of them. Okay, so that is what, it's a constant there, can will be produced. So it won't, a proportionality constant, you can say. Okay, so your static friction will be proportional to your normal. To exhibit this proportionality, we are introducing this. Okay, and also this one more quick cases. This will be lesser than or equal to the normal force, and it will be having a coefficient also. Okay, so this is what about your static friction. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay. So now we'll see about the kinetic friction. So kinetic means, we know what is kinetic, right? Nothing but whenever a body is moving, okay, it will be having a kinetic energy for that. Okay, energy possessed when it is moving, when the body is moving. Kinetic simply means movement. Okay, so kinetic friction is the force of a friction which comes into play between two surfaces when there is some relative motion between them. Okay, So when there is some relative motion between them, so in this place, kinetic friction will be there. And the magnitude of the force of the kinetic friction will be expressed by Fk. Okay, this is kinetic frictional force. And that is proportional to the normal force again, okay, with a proportionality constant mu k, which is the coefficient of kinetic friction, okay. So here also the same thing. Thus, coefficient of kinetic friction will be a ratio of your frictional force, kinetic friction divided by normal. So this is what the same like the static friction, but there will be a, your kinetic friction will be accompanied with the motion also. Right, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then take the notes of the slide. We'll move. Completed.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, with the kinetic friction and kinetic energy are different, ma'am, or same?
Well, kinetic friction is something force. It is okay. Kinetic energy is see, energy and forces are different, right? So that difference will be there for your kinetic frictional force and your energy.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Right. Everyone finished this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. We'll see this next topics in the next class. We'll have a small quiz now and we'll end our session. Okay. Shall we? Shall we have a quiz?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let me stop sharing this. Right. Okay. So now, can anyone say what are the types of motion that you can find?
Ma'am, linear motion, oscillatory motion.
Right then.
Circular motion.
Circular motion. Okay. Anything else you're finding? What types of motion? Any others also?
Uniform motion, ma'am. Non-uniform motion.
Uniform and non-uniform motion. See. Right. Okay. So that is inside this. Okay. But basic types I'm asking. Oh, there are just three motions. Basic motions. Who can answer this?
Ma'am, rotational, ma'am.
Rotational, okay. That is one.
Translational and oscillatory, ma'am.
Yeah, correct. Okay, so these are the three motions. And what about the linear?
Linear
and,
motion, ma'am.
Yeah, what about the linear and circular motion? Or no, circular motion is something different. It is type of a motion which will go around, okay, but to say this linear motion will be coming under the translation motion, okay. Even the circulatory motion, that will also come under translation motion, but in a case, you know, a curvilinear motion, you can tell it, you can include that into, but when it goes to a full circle, it won't go there, so it will be a separate motion. So in discrete, to say there are four motions. One is translatory, circulatory, rotational, and vibrational or oscillation. Anything you can say. Vibrations are nothing but oscillations, okay? So these are the types of motion. Good. Okay. Then, right. Can anyone give the formula for impulse? Puneet and Stephen Daniel, you haven't spoken, so I request you to speak now. So for impulse, yes. Stephen Daniel, are you there?
Ma'am.
Yeah, Gopika.
Ma'am, momentum is equal to force into time.
Momentum is equal to force into
time.
Right. Is it momentum, Gopika?
Change in momentum, ma'am.
Change in momentum. Okay. Yeah. So it is nothing but your impulse. Right? So it is your impulse. That is your, you know, having the your force, how much force you are supplying with the time. With the time being, you tell it as impulse, right? It is not momentum. It is a change in momentum. It is not the momentum. Okay, right.
Ma'am, mass of the body in motion, ma'am.
Mass of the body in motion. That is not impulses. What?
Ma'am,
yeah. Yes, Hardika, what were you saying? Right, okay. Okay, we'll move ahead now. Then what question you can ask? Right. Okay, can anyone say what will be the opposite force of gravitational force in a body?
I'm in a body, ma'am.
Yes, in a body. What will be the opposite for your gravitational force? Or you can say, yeah, because of the weight. Opposite to your weight.
Weightless.
Anyone?
Ma'am, normal.
Normal force.
Normal force, it is. Yeah, right? Okay. What else I can ask? So can anyone tell the formula for pressure?
Force
per
area.
Force per unit area, ma'am.
Yeah, just force per unit area. Have you surfed the Google then? The answer is coming late.
Ma'am, no, ma'am. I know force, ma'am, but per unit time or area, I had the doubt, ma'am. So.
Right. Okay. Force per unit area it is. Just think, okay, what is pressure? Just imagine a contained box, okay? So whatever the force you are giving to that area, that will be the pressure inside that contained body. That in that way, you can remember them for, you know, you can store it in your mind easily. Force per unit area is what your pressure is. Right, okay, what else can I ask? So some examples for contact force.
Frictional force, ma'am.
Okay, right.
Muscular force.
Yeah. Okay.
Normal force, ma'am.
Mechanical force. Yeah, mechanical force can be coming. Yes. Normal. Annabelle, can you tell me one?
Ma'am, muscular force, ma'am.
Yes, muscular force already they've told. Any others? Yeah, Gopika.
Applied force.
Applied force. Okay. Right. It can be coming.
Spring force, ma'am.
Ma'am, air resistance force.
Tension spring force.
Tension. Yeah, good. Okay. So these are the forces. Okay, so. Yeah, right. Okay. So good people. Okay, we can end the session here. We'll see the rest of the things in the next session. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, students, thank you.
Ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Bye, ma'am. Merry Christmas, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you,
all.
Ma'am.
Thank you.
Christmas, ma'am.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.